the school fair on Sunday, would you pick up all the sodas and at some place down in Pico and wherever, and deliver to them to the Simpson's house? When you get there, just ring the gate, the housekeeper will come out, and you put them in the pool house. That's all you have to do. I said, great. Okay. I was going to the fair later on, school fair, at the Simpsons house. I go down, I pick up the sodas, I get to the Simpsons house. The gate is wide open and I'm ringing the bell and nobody's coming out. And then I go stand in the driveway. And again, remember, in the Simpson trial, all these locations are being talked about time and time again. So I'm standing in the driveway where there were droplets of blood found later. And I'm yelling, hello, I'm here with the sodas for the school fair, and nobody's coming out. So I start carrying cases of soda down to the pool house. And about my third trip, I walk out of the pool house and the white Ferrari pulls into the house and OJ gets out. And now Nicole Simpson runs out of the house and she starts yelling at him, like screaming, you blah, 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 you blah, 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 I hate you, you're out. And she starts sort of like kind of hitting him on his shoulder, not like a whack or anything, but just like really angry, you so and so, you're ruining our children's fair. But now at this point, OJ, first of all, he's huge. You just can't believe what it would be like to tackle that guy. And this is after the battery charge where he's been arrested for hitting her. So all of a sudden, I think, oh my God, he's going to do something here and I'm going to have to step in to fight OJ. It couldn't have been more the opposite, where he was like, cool, no, baby, you got to understand. I was playing golf and she's yelling at him, and they go in the house. I tiptoe out of the yard. I get to my truck. I leave all the sodas on the curb outside the driveway, and I drive 180 miles an hour to get out of there. Anyway, that's my OJ story, which was, I didn't mention that to anyone during the trial. I did not want to be a character witness. Anyway, let's introduce my guests, my old friends. Dr. D, can I get that drum roll? Okay, here we are. This is a long intro, guys. Get ready. They are the screenwriters of some really huge films. Who Framed Roger Rabbit, directed by Bob Zemeckis, Doc Hollywood with Michael J. Fox, Wild Wild West with Will Smith. I hope he slapped you. That would be so funny. We could talk about that if he slapped you. How the Grinch Stole Christmas with Jim Carrey, directed by Ron Howard. Last Holiday with Queen Latifah, Shrek the Third. And let's get to the TV world because they wrote and directed the great TV cult hit Johnny Bago, which I played four parts in. And the greatest episode, there were two episodes, but my episode is the greatest, of Tales from the Crypt, My Brother's Keeper. Please welcome Peter S. Seaman and Jeffrey Price. Yay!
Wow, thank you, Tim. I forgot we did all those things.
Boy, that was nice. It was impressive.
It really is, though, impressive. I mean, those are big box office movies that you guys wrote, which explains your nice backdrops and your nice lives you have now. So good for you.
Yeah.
So
My camera is sitting on a stack of about 10 or 15 scripts that never got made, though, Tim.
That's okay. We would want to talk about that. So let's go back to Chicago. I don't know what year it was you met, but I know you met in an advertising agency. That's correct, right?
That's
That's
right.
right. 1974. I came to work at Leo Burnett, and Jeff was my boss.
I
And
didn't know that.
yeah, he
I
was
thought you had like two underlings who were put together.
well, Jeff was away making a commercial, and he came back to find me in his group, and he was not happy about that. So he
Is
was quite mean to me, very mean.
that true, Jeff?
I don't remember that at all. I thought, who's the new kid? I was only 24 myself, so.
And what was the account like? What Tony Tiger was the big account, right? The Kellogg's, was that your big account?
We worked on a lot of different Kellogg's commercials, and we worked on Nestle candy bars.
Really?
And we used to do Doers profiles, you know, those ones were, you know, those fascinating profiles of people. We did
white sauce.
Union Carbide Glad garbage bags. He's probably wondering, why didn't we stay in the advertising business?
I don't think so. Not after I read those credits. I think you made the right move.
We also worked on Oldsmobile, which a brand that no longer exists.
Yeah.
I think we helped it on its way.
But the Olds 88 was a good, that was a good car.
The Cutlass was our car, the one that we worked on. Do you remember the Cutlass was the most popular car in America? Boy, this is getting to be a sad conversation.
No, it's good. I love it.
One of the things I'll mention is because Peter and I, because we did Kellogg's commercials, we used to work with all the animation houses in Los Angeles, whose animators used to animate cartoons, you know, in the good old days. There were all these old guys who worked for these production companies. And it was really because of that that we later tied in with Roger Rabbit, because we used to go out drinking with all these, you know, these guys in their 60s. We'd go to Bordner's in Hollywood and have lunch with them.
Youngsters now.
Yeah. Bordner's was the place where these guys would go and drink martinis and have meatballs in this little crock pot and then go back to work, you know, and look in those little vanity mirrors on their desk and slap their faces and
get make back to work.
Exaggerated expressions, you know.
That's funny. Yeah. Ordner's became a hipster bar, I guess, because of what happened then when you
was the meatballs.
Well, I think it's pretty incredible that it became a hipster bar.
Yeah, I remember the first guy who took me there was like a young hipster guy. He said, yeah, come on to Bordner's. I was like, I think it's kind of a dive. He said, yeah, that's the point. That's why we go. So then how did, I mean, suddenly you're in advertising. Did you both say, I want to write movies? Is that what happened? Like, you're working together. You obviously get to know each other. Jeff had done a little showbiz work with my friend Jim Stein way back in junior high school. So do you suddenly say to each other, like, let's write a movie? Is that how it happened?
No, so I quit first to write a movie. The movie I picked to write, Eight Men Out, about the Black Sox scandal.
Right.
It turned out that 45 other screenwriters had also written that as their first screenplay. And so when I got done with it, just then they announced that John Sayles was going to direct Eight Men Out. So, and Jeff, by that time, quit on his own. I believe you were writing a play, weren't you, Jeff?
I was writing a play. And, you know, people, when I tell people this, they don't believe it. But in Chicago, when at 9 o'clock in the morning, there was nobody on the sidewalk at all. Everybody's at their desk at a job.
Right.
People don't wander around and go to coffee houses or anything like that. This is, you know, in the 1970s. And, you know, I just stayed in my apartment because I was embarrassed to go out on the street and have people think I didn't have a job. So
that's until 12:30 when the Cubs played in Wrigley Field. And then it was okay to be outside.
So Peter and I, you know, we called each other up and said, hey, you know, let's have lunch, you know, and we'll talk about, we were lonely from the kinds of, you know, give and take we used to have in the advertising agency. You know, you go in, get a cup of coffee, get a pack of cigarettes, sit there, put your feet up on the desk, you know, and bull around for a couple hours until lunch, you know.
Right.
So then we said, let's work together on something. But then the first thing we worked together on was going to Wrigley Field every day.
So not working.
What?
So not to be seen, not working.
Because yeah, and we were with the other degenerates in the right field bleachers, you know. And we would go there every day. We invested all of our emotions in the Cubs.
It didn't work out very well.
So then how did you guys then decide to write a script together on spec?
Yes.
And what was that script?
That was called Mr. Whistle, which was about a delusional advertising copywriter. I don't know where we got that notion from.
Well, I did want to mention that it was funny that at the same time, John Hughes also worked at that agency, right? When you guys were there.
Yes. Yeah.
That's right.
He was on the Kellogg Sugar Pops account. Jeff did Snap, Crackle, and Pop, and I did Tony the Tiger.
So your paths would cross via Kellogg.
We didn't know him very well. You know, Tim Kazurinsky and Don Novello were also working there at the time.
Really?
They were both on Saturday Night Live. He was, of course, Father Guido Sarducci.
Yeah. That's so funny. And then, how did we get to Roger Rabbit? Like, how many scripts did it take to get to Roger Rabbit? And how did Roger Rabbit happen? Clearly, the Tony the Tiger animation didn't hurt your process.
No. So as Jeff said, when we were offered, we wrote Mr. Whistle, which I think got us an agent. And then we wrote a script called Good King Harry, which we sold actually to Tish and Avnet. And it almost got made about 50 times, and we sort of made a living off it, but it never actually got made. And that got us, I believe, the offer. Was that to do Trench Coat at that point?
Yeah, a Trench Coat.
At Disney.
That was our first paying studio job. Everything else we'd done on spec.
And what was Trench Coat?
That was Marco Kidder.
Oh. That doesn't show up on IMDb, on your IMDb. I never knew about Trench Coat.
It was not a very good movie. It was a movie, and we got hired to do it. It was almost like Romancing the Stone, which came out at exactly the same time. Except Romancing the Stone was a huge hit, and Trench Coat was a dog. But on the way to Trench Coat sort of tanking, we got hired to work on Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which at the time was a book called Who Censored Roger Rabbit.
And it was about comic strips. It wasn't about anime. It wasn't about cartoon people.
Right. So you guys, and you mentioned Romancing the Stone with Bob Zemeckis, and he was attached to it from the beginning?
No. So we finished the, it was about 1980, I guess. When we finished the first draft, he had not, I don't think he'd made Romancing the Stone yet. And he was kind of in movie jail because he'd done even though these movies are good, I Want to Hold Your Hand and Used Cars. He wasn't able to, Disney didn't want to hire him to do the Roger Rabbit script we wrote, which we were hoping he would get hired on, but he didn't. And so the script got put into turnaround, sadly, and because we loved the thing. And then one of those moments that screenwriters always dream about but never happened, which is that years later, after Bob had made Romancing the Stone and Back to the Future, Spielberg had picked up the project by then and given it to Bob. Said, "Here, this is a project we're high on." Bob read it, said, "No, this isn't the script I remember. There was this other script by these two guys, Seaman and Price. Let's find that one." So you get this call out of the blue 5 years later that said, Bob Zemeckis wants to talk to you about your version of Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
So one of the things that saved us was when we were working on it, we were thinking, well, Roger Rabbit's supposed to be famous, right? Well, how does the audience know, that he's this famous cartoon character?
Right.
So we thought, we need to write a Roger Rabbit cartoon. It'll start off the movie. So people know that Roger Rabbit was a big star, and you know, this is how the whole conceit works. And then, you know, he walks off the set and you go, wait a minute.
Right.
He's walking around with regular people, which is sort of a mind blowing thing. At least then it was.
Great. It's perfect. It sets off.
So that was the thing that was on the front of our scripts. And Zemeckis said, yeah, there was one I read that had a cartoon at the beginning of it.
Yeah.
And because there had been other people working on it.
I didn't.
That saved our bacon.
Wow. Never do that. That's a great, great story. Okay. We're coming up. We're going to take our first break. I've got Peter Seaman and Jeff Price with me today. And I'm just going to give you a couple of plugs, guys. Jeff's book, Improbable Fortunes. It's a novel of the West, which you have become a man of the West. You can buy that on Amazon. And Peter's documentary, West of the West, Tales from the Channel Islands, which I've seen many times. You can get that on Amazon. So that's cool. Personal plug, you can watch Sprung on Freevee, also owned by Amazon. I guess they own everything. And on Twitter at TV's Tim Stack. Let's take our first break. You're listening to It's Radio with TV's Tim Stack. We'll be right back.
And I do have the sound bite that you wanted from Roger Rabbit. Okay.
That's coming.
Tim, can I blow my nose now?
I have the intro bit, but I also have the long Roger Rabbit bit all for, right?
Yes.
That'll be during the.
Oh yeah, it'll be pretty early on, okay. But you're going to open with the Johnny Bago soundtrack, right?
That's correct.
Okay,
classic
good.
TV themes, Johnny Bago.
Great.
In stereo.
Jesus, Tim, you've done a lot of work on this thing.
Did you pull the Johnny Bago thing off of YouTube?
Yes. All those episodes are up there.
Which episode were you in?
I was in four of them.
Were you in the missile silo?
I was in the one where Jesus is on the windshield.
Oh, I like it.
Spotted Owl? You were in the Spotted Owl one.
Spotted Owl one? Yeah, that's the one where I played the woman.
Yeah.
And
you were beautiful.
Beautiful. We're going to talk about that.
You were Armed Mastriani.
Life's too complicated. It's too complex.
I was set up. I did not do it.
Bounce from town to town like rubber checks.
Johnny Baker.
Didn't know at the time I'd pay double for the crime. Not to mention a serious problem with the opposite sex.
I'm his ex-wife.
I guess that's bringing that. Like an anchovy to an alley cat. Johnny Bagel's gonna have to stay a little further down the lost highway.
Okay, yay! We're back with Peter Seaman and Jeff Price. That was the theme to a TV show, which you can find on YouTube, called Johnny Bago, which we're going to talk about in a second. But I want to go back to Roger Rabbit for 1 second. Dr. D is going to play a clip from Roger Rabbit, and then I have a sort of a big macro question to ask you after that. So, Dr. D, whenever you're ready.
This tale of an up-and-coming movie star named Roger Rabbit. The down and out private detective. Every moment they were together, there's a new adventure in trouble.
Hide me, Eddie! Please!
It's a motion about friendship.
Please, Eddie! Don't tell me I've been making a big mistake!
Love. Compassion.
Well, I'm sorry I yanked your ears.
All the time he yanked my ears?
Murder.
Marvin Acme. The rabbit cacked him last night.
Remember, you never saw me.
Sex.
I'd do anything for my husband, Mr. Valiant. Anything.
And violence. Twos gets him every time.
You wouldn't have any idea where the rabbit might be.
Got a thing for rabbits, huh?
The whole thing stinks like yesterday's diapers.
It's a comedy a little different from all the rest.
Give it
jerk! I'm a tomb!
I'm not bad. I'm just drawn that way.
But tell me, Eddie, is that a rabbit in your pocket? You're just happy to see me.
There we go. So I wanted to go back to Roger Rabbit as sort of an intro. This was around that time you were talking, those dates you were talking. So Peter and I have both been fans. And Jeff, I don't know if you read this book by Sam Wasson called Chinatown and the Last Years of Hollywood. And it's about the film Chinatown and those guys who made it. But it's also about like the 70s, the great filmmaking that came out of Hollywood in the 70s, and then sort of how it went away. And you guys were lucky enough to sort of catch the tail end of that great period. Am I right?
That's right.
We were two weeks ahead of our time, Tim.
it caved pretty soon after we got there. But you know, we were able to meet a lot of great, you know, famous old people too, who were still around then.
Right, and the town. Sort of like, I mean, you came out of advertising, which must have had the Mad Men feel, but even you describing Bordner's and the guys having martinis and meatballs, the fact that Hollywood was not corporate yet, it was still, you know, guys were making, or women were making creative decisions based on creative, not based on numbers. Am I right?
I think that's somewhat true.
It was just dying out, that was true.
Yeah,
it was the studio system was still sort of alive because we worked at several of them, and it was like being in a family, kind of like the old days. You know, there were writers on the lot, directors on the lot. You have lunch at the commissary all together, and it was kind of cool, but it was going away.
Yeah, but I mean, I remember your offices at Universal. I remember exactly where they were, and it was across from the commissary. And at the time, the Universal commissary was kind of the place to have lunch, like. You had to get a reservation, and it was a big deal because there were going to be big deals in that commissary. You'd see Spielberg, you know, was Hitchcock around at all when you guys were there?
No, but I'll tell you what, when Lou Wasserman would walk in to have his lunch, no matter who, you know, everyone stopped talking.
Right.
Everyone stopped talking and kind of lowered their heads just in case he saw you.
Am I paying you?
What are you doing here? We got kind of a whiff of the end of that, you know, that era.
Yeah, so great. Which makes me think of Lou Wasserman, and that there's a documentary called The Last Mogul. I don't know if you've seen that. It's pretty good. It's Lou. He had quite a life. So let's go back to Johnny Bago again, because I think. First of all, tell the premise of Johnny Bago, and then tell the story of how you sold it, because that's one of the great TV sales stories that I can remember. So whoever wants to tell the premise.
Well, the premise is that there's a guy who's out. He's on probation, and he's a guy from, you know, like he's sort of a Brooklyn guy, and his probation officer is his ex-wife. I mean, that's the nut of it. But the thing was that when we were thinking about, like, what kind of TV show could we come up with? And we were thinking, like, what are our favorite ones? So, and we were thinking about The Fugitive.
Yeah.
And in The Fugitive, he comes into the episode and there's a problem and he solves it. And then he's being wanted by Robert Morris. So he has to run away at the end of it. So we said, well, what happens if he, instead of helping people, he screws things up for people every time?
Yeah, it's great. It makes their life worse. And then he gets his Winnebago and goes on to his next deed. So, Pierre, tell us about, first of all, the people involved with that show, how it only did 6 episodes. I mean, it was Frank Marshall and Bob Zemeckis and Jimmy Buffett wrote the theme song and you guys and...
And you.
And me for 4 episodes. Peter Dobson played the lead. Rose Abdu played the wife. She's had a nice little resurgence lately. I don't know if you've seen her. She's on.
No, but I'm glad. She was hugely talented and fun to work with.
Yeah. She, working on Hacks, and there was another one, too. She's doing well. That's great. A bunch of other guest stars I was thinking about. Michael Gazzo, who played Frank Pantangeli in Godfather 2, who was kind of like Frank Pantangeli, if I remember, on the set.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Like, I don't think I remember. Like, it was not easy getting him to get his lines down. I remember that.
Yeah. It was pretty kind of sad.
And Rip Taylor was...
right.
Who was...
Dub Taylor.
And Dub Taylor.
Dub Taylor. And in the circus episode, what was his name, Peter?
I just remember the human ice cream cone, Jeff.
Anyway, I'll tell you, we had a lot of fun doing that show. It was perverse.
Yeah, it really was. I mean, to explain it, like, I played the TV reporter. Every time they had a TV reporter in the show, I played the part. And so they were all different characters, one of which was a woman. I played a female TV reporter. Obviously, that would never fly today. And a little side story with that, the outfit they got me for that episode was they couldn't find a woman's outfit in my size because I was 6'4", until they found the one that John Lithgow wore in The World According to Garp.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, and now my niece happens to be his assistant. That's it all comes around.
Well, you know, I don't think, you know, Peter, you should tell them about how we pitched the idea to the different networks.
That was inspired. Actually, I have a funny story about that too. So we decided we would pitch the networks in a Winnebago. So we had it scheduled out. It was like a half an hour, whatever. Per network, and we told the guy to be at the corner of whatever Lancashire, whatever, 12 o'clock. We pull this Winnebago over, and on the guy would get his assistant, and then we hijacked him and drove the streets of L.A.
Right.
While we pitched this thing. And I mean, it was the pitch was so overwhelming that we got offers from all the different networks.
Of course you did. It's just beautiful.
So CBS finally, we signed up for CBS, which is maybe the wrong network for it. It was kind of the old days. I think Johnny Vega would have done a lot better on cable. But so we, Peter Tortorici was running the network at the time, and they signed us up for 8 shows. And then when it started playing, it wasn't finding, as they say, finding its audience. And I think Frank Marshall had to use all his power to keep us on the air for the 6 episode it played. So recently I ran into Peter Tortorici after all these years. And I introduced myself. I said, you know, you probably remember, Johnny Vega, and he said, oh, yeah. And he looked at me and went, that was the greatest pitch I've ever heard. But nothing about the show.
Yeah, right. Hey, listen, when I was listening to Jimmy Buffett sing that song right now,
yeah,
I was thinking, why the hell didn't we have a Jimmy Buffett bagel shop? We would have been billionaires.
Johnny Bagel. So Johnny Bagel is, anyway, it's on YouTube if you want to watch it. It's just great. So, but you guys, I also find your lives interesting that they intersected because Peter's kind of a waspy kid from the northern suburbs of Chicago, and Jeff is a Jewish kid from Highland Park, and yet you've gone in different, like Peter becomes a screenwriter, and Jeff, you are like literally a sheriff. Am I right?
Well, I was a deputy sheriff reserve for 3 years.
Yeah, but you rode around cars and
I did that, yeah.
Did you arrest anybody?
Yeah, I did.
Because
you know, I don't know why, but first of all, I'm from Glencoe, not Highland Park.
Sorry.
The other thing is that nobody ever seems to want to believe that I was a deputy sheriff. I don't know why.
You once said to me, I'll never forget the line. You said, because you were talking about hunting, I was like, really, Jeff, you like to hunt? He goes, oh, I just love it. He goes, but my friends who I went to high school with, their idea of hunting is ordering a steak at the Palm.
Yeah.
Like, you went a whole other path from...
But you know what? So did Peter.
Yeah.
You know? Peter was sort of a breakaway guy from his background. We were renegades.
But the fact that you found each other in advertising and both kind of didn't get any satisfaction from it and moved on and both got into screenwriting. It's just, it's a real.
You know what? I, you're leaving out an important thing, which is I never had mayonnaise until I met Peter. You know, where I came from, we had Miracle Whip. And I said, what is this? He says, that's mayonnaise. I said, holy, I was about to say a bad word, but holy cow.
Yeah, said, you're going to like it. And he did.
This is fantastic.
Peter had mayonnaise on tap at home. That was like, he is.
And we actually, you know, Peter and I had a lot of common interests. I mean, besides being in the advertising business, because we both liked to hunt and fish and, you know, so we did all that. And we, you know, I think there's a lot of Chicago guys who are attracted to the mountains in the West.
That's interesting. I didn't know that, but I don't know. It's just, it's interesting that you guys, it's a great journey that you've had together, and also a lot of golf with the three of us. Thanks to Peter's dad, we got to play golf at Augusta, which
that's right.
Going to be on my gravestone. Yeah, I played Augusta. That's under the dates that I love. Okay, we're going to take another break. We're coming up. I'm talking to Peter Seaman and Jeff Price, great screenwriters, great careers in Hollywood, Improbable Fortunes, Jeff's novel on Amazon, West of the West, Peter's documentary on Amazon. You can watch Sprung from me, well, Greg Garcia, on Amazon, Freevee. And you're listening to It's Radio with TV's Tim Stack. And we will be right back.
Okay. Now for the next.
Tim is really good.
Yeah, Tim, you are good.
Jim West, Desperado, Rough Rider. No, you don't want nada. None of this. Six gunning this, brother running this. Fucking no soldier. Look, it's like I told you. Any damsel that's in distress, be out of that dress when she meet Jim West.
Okay, a little Wild Wild West there. Starring Will Smith. Now, let's talk about that movie. And we don't talk about Will Smith. Although I do want to know, like, when he slapped Chris on the Oscars, were you surprised?
Well, I mean, first of all, like everybody in America, we thought it was a joke probably at first, but you know,
so
on the set, I will say this: on the set of, we used to hang around with Barry Sonnenfeld, the director, and Will would be there, you know, time to time, and they would play a game where you hold your hands out, you know, together in front of you, and the other guy has his hands behind his back, and then he tries to slap your hands.
Yes.
And I saw when I think Jeff was there one time when Barry couldn't ever beat Will, and he got his hand slapped about 100 times in a row. And yeah. After that incident, I did harken back to that.
Yeah, he slaps hard. I just want to say that Peter and I, there were two occasions when we had to like be in the same hotel room, you know, with our stars of an upcoming movie, and we spent about 2 or 3 weeks with Kevin Klein and Will Smith while they were, you know, hacking around through our script.
Right.
But then I remember we had a really wonderful time with, you know, John Candy and Carl Reiner. We spent a couple of weeks at the Westwood Marquee with these guys. Every day we would spend working on another script that became Last Holiday, but unfortunately John Candy died. And they were hilarious, you know.
Oh, I'm
Carl God. Reiner, as you can imagine. But also John Candy was a very funny, sweet guy. Too bad that, you know, we lost him.
Oh, my God. And
Carl Reiner's rule was, have a good idea, go to lunch.
Honestly, you know what? So many people believe in that. You know, when we mention that, they go, yeah, that's how I work, too. Have a good idea, go to lunch.
Have you guys seen the documentary, The Last Automat, or The Automat?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's good. Carl Reiner's in it, and they talk.
Yeah.
I could see him saying that about lunch, because clearly the coffee at the Automat was really an important part of his life. You could see, I could absolutely see that. So at this point, Wild Wild West, you guys are on a fast track, right? Like, the Hollywood is trying to get you to write their next script, I'm guessing, because you're dealing with Barry Sonnenfeld and Will Smith and Wild Wild West, which would have been a huge property at the time.
We were working on The Grinch too at that time.
So we rewrote Wild Wild West. That was a rewrite. And actually, at the time, I think George Clooney was attached with Will. Yeah.
So let's talk about the because I know you guys rewrote The Nutty Professor with Eddie Murphy. And
uncredited.
Right. But you were on set for a lot of it, right? Weren't you?
We did the production rewrite.
Right. So you're not credited, but you're there at the end. And my buddy from high school, Josh King, was the AD, I believe.
Yes.
That. So, but let's talk about, I never got hired to rewrite anybody. So how do you attack the rewrite process? Do you just go in like, we don't even care what this script says? Or are you looking for things that work and versus things that don't work?
Well, in our situations, we were usually late to the game, so there's already director on it, and there in some cases there was film shot, like The Nutty Professor, and sometimes there was a problem that everybody could recognize. Sometimes there was a cast change or an opportunity, so it wasn't like we just went off and did whatever we wanted. It was usually, you know, writing to you know, whatever issue was the problem and or the opportunity.
And in the case of, again, I have no knowledge of it, no experience in it. In the case of a film, if the director is already on board, you are listening to him or her, right? Things that they like, things they don't like, things they need, things they don't want. Is that sort of how it goes?
Well, yes, but I think that in this job, we were trying to please Eddie Murphy, you know, because he was, you know, he was the man here.
Right.
Also, when we first had him, we were supposed to have a meeting with Eddie Murphy on the back lot, and went to the trailer, the production trailer. And we were, there was sort of like a bodyguard at the door. And then we were waiting outside. Then the guy let us in and we sat down. And there was another guy in there, this big fat guy. And he was sitting there. We were sitting there in utter silence, not saying anything to him. And it turned out we were sitting with Eddie Murphy that whole time. He was made up, you know, as the fat guy Clum. And we didn't even know it was him.
That's a great scene.
So, yeah. So then the powers that be on the film had not been happy with some of the buddy love stuff, the alter ego Sherman Clum. And so we were kind of brought into to try to help rewrite that part of the movie. So everybody sits down in the trailer and there's Eddie, and we recognize it's Eddie. And there's a great moment.
He talked about Eddie while he was there, like, yo, fat guy, when's Eddie gonna show?
Yeah, right.
So then one of the producers or the studio head turns to us and goes, okay, guys, tell Eddie why that buddy love stuff doesn't work. Yeah. Of course, you dumped that job on the poor screenwriters, you know.
Yeah.
Well, the director didn't want to get fired. You know, I gotta say that we did a lot of structural work on it, you know, like the second act. I can't remember exactly what. And then Eddie, the guy is such a genius. I mean, he would make up a lot of his stuff. But they said, you know, look, when Eddie finally, when he drinks that potion and he loses the weight,
yeah,
and his, you know, he shrinks down to being a skinny guy and his pants fall off around his shoes, we need a line. So, you know, we thought for a minute, we said, okay, when his pants fall down, he looks down and he says, hey, I can see my blank.
Right.
And they used it.
Yeah, yeah. No, everybody remembers that line. I bet Eddie loved it. That's great. So, okay, that's interesting about the rewrite stuff. I didn't know that, that it's all so different. So after Nutty Professor, let's go back to Doc Hollywood. Was that obviously post Roger Rabbit? Was that something, an idea that you guys came up with, or was that brought to you?
That was another book. That was another book that was brought to us. It was called What Dead Again? And that became Doc Hollywood. So we actually went to Georgia and did a lot of research with it. The writer of it was a doctor, and he took us all over Georgia. You know, we went to, you know, met a sheriff at moonshine and went to these great churches, and we immersed in that world. It was really, really fun research.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I want to interject something. You know, Peter and I, coming from Chicago, we had great UHF channel and Channel 9 in Chicago that used to play a lot of Ealing comedies. And Peter and I were both big fans of the Ealing comedies, you know, the British comedies of the 1950s. Ealing comedies, you know, like The Man in the White Suit, The Lady Killer.
Killer.
Oh,
you know, yes. All of those films. So the thing about it, and what, you know, we just carried around with us internally, was that in these comedies, these British comedies, even though they were funny, they were always about something.
Right.
And so we tried to apply that to our work when we would take these rewrites or we take these jobs. And Doc Hollywood was one of those things where there was a real paucity of doctor care in the South in rural areas. We thought, this is great. It's a lot like a Frank Capra movie, and it's also a lot like an Ealing comedy.
Yes, it is. Yeah, and I can absolutely see that. And the idea, well, I don't know. My personal process is I always try to break a story dramatically. I worry. I mean, yeah, you want jokes there. You know, you want to make sure there's going to be jokes there, but, you know, to make sure the story works. And anyway, okay, we're going to come up on our third break now. I'm talking to Peter Seaman and Jeff Price. I'm going to plug them again. Jeffrey's book, Improbable Fortunes, a Western novel, I just love that you sort of found the West. Peter's documentary, West of the West, about the Channel Islands, super interesting, on Amazon. You can find my work in the show Sprung on Amazon, and me at TV's Tim Stack on Twitter. Okay, we're going to take a break, and we'll wrap it up in our final segment right after this. I'm talking to Peter Seaman and Jeff Price, and it's radio with TV's Tim Stack. Okay, a little music from Tales from the Crypt right there, which it's all going to come full circle. How I met these guys, Peter Seaman and Jeff Price, I'm talking to, great screenwriters and screenwriters directors of an episode of Tales from the Crypt called My Brother's Keeper, which is a lot of people love. I see on the internet, just love that episode, the Siamese twins. And or I can say to Bundy, hey, I did a Tales from the Crypt. Which one? Oh, the Siamese twins. Oh, my God, that was you. I get a lot of that. So I want to hear from you guys how we met, and then I'll tell you my version of how we met, because it's kind of crazy. Who wants to go first?
Why don't you go first? I don't remember how. Peter, do you remember how we met?
Yeah, I remember. So we were going to hire the Stack brothers to play Siamese twins. Made sense. You know, looked alike enough. Comedy, both worked in comedy. Tim's brother, at that point, just did he? I can't remember, Tim, why he
He got into advertising. He left showbiz. He did the opposite of you guys. He got into advertising.
Oh, no. Okay. So that just happened. So Tim came in, but without his brother. So we needed to audition other people that looked like Tim, because we wanted Tim. But we needed somebody that was, you know, about his height and, you know, had to be attached at the butt, as you may want to talk about. But so the day we had Tim come in for the audition, or one, and one of the other actors, you remember this, Jeff, suddenly grabbed a knife that we had used to cut our sandwich for lunch that was still on the table.
But it was a knife. It wasn't like a butter knife.
No, yeah, it was, and put it to Tim's throat. And Tim was, of course, unprepared for that, as were we. Okay, hang on a second. But Tim, actually, Tim, you know, and I don't, you can speak to this, Tim, but you stormed out, and I we didn't really blame you, and I ran out after you.
Yeah, but the best thing is, as I stormed out, as I'm leaving the door, I'm thinking to myself, if this guy comes out in the parking lot, I got this part. I got these guys over a barrel here. Because so just held a sharp knife to my throat. What happened was my brother, we went into audition with John Stark, who went on to become a great writer, wrote the show According to Jim, with Jim Belushi, Chicago guy. And so my brother wasn't available. I said, John, come in. So we went in audition, and then you guys asked me, hey, would you read with this other actor who you didn't know was a serial killer, apparently. Like. Anyway, that's how I met them. And I never thought, part of me thinking with storming out was, I never thought I'd get the part, because if you remember the Lawrence brothers, one was on 90210 and his Mitchell and Matt Lawrence were identical twins. So when we walked into the audition room, it was like, oh my God, these guys, who would not cast them? They're identical twins. They look exactly alike, but you guys went a different way. And again, that one, you can find Tales from the Crypt. I don't know where. I know there are a bunch of episodes on YouTube, and it's really, it's a great episode. I just watched it again not too long ago. It's really super clever and fun. And Jessica Harper. Yes. Yes. Is in the episode. And, yeah, it's really, really fun and funny. And yeah. And I always felt like the Farrelly Brothers movie that they did with conjoined twins. We do say Siamese twins in the episode, which I don't think you'd be allowed to say now.
You wouldn't be able to do that episode. I don't think we'd be allowed now.
I don't think that you could do Johnny Bago now.
You could do Johnny Bago on cable. You could do it because ultimately he had a good heart, and it wasn't like, you know, it's not like you can't. Like, there's no way you could do Son of the Beach now. But Johnny Bago, I think you could do Johnny Bago. Well, the show I worked on, Sprung, and Greg Garcia's shows, there's a lot of Johnny Bago in his shows. My Name is Earl and Raising Hope. And it's like low-rent people finding a way and fish out of water stuff. That's certainly what Sprung is, which is another way to plug that show. but anyway, it was just that we met and we all stayed friends after that. And it was just, it was really hard work. I remember that episode. Like, we worked some crazy hours. Part of it was the makeup when what was called the web, which was attaching John. It was a lot of like, it was a production experience I never had. Like that kind of thing. Like, okay, Tim, you can't go to the bathroom for the next 6 hours.
Good luck. You know, of all the things we did, the web came out the best of anything we ever, you know, on such a limited budget.
Yeah.
But it you know, it was heart pounding work to shoot all those pages in a day.
Yes.
You know, because you had to do them in, I think, 5 or 6 days.
Yes.
And wow, I mean, it was heart pounding.
Yeah.
No. For Tim's birthday this year, I gave him the underwear from that show.
Yes.
How did you have that
underwear?
I don't know, but it's got the, you know, it was sewed together to allow for the web. Oh, the web.
Yeah. Who bought that on eBay? But somebody did. Anyway, Some Tales from the Crypt Freak. I could probably sell that on eBay. You guys, great careers. I do want to mention both of your wives, because they're both interesting people. And Nene, Peter's wife, is an artist. And just last week, I went to, which I just love this setup. It's like a sitcom for PBS. Peter's wife and his daughter share an art studio, but they don't go there at the same time. Am I right?
That's correct. Never.
It's really funny, but it's a mother-daughter art studio. That's what I'm saying, CBS. Like, nobody else is going to buy that, but CBS. But they both do, which is also interesting, they both do work in watercolors with really bright, fun colors, but they're both completely different. Like, they're anyway, could you speak to that a little bit, Peter?
No.
Because you don't want to get in trouble. You
know, after I get off this thing, Tim, I have a life to go back to.
It's really.
No, I mean, I will say that they're, you know, that studio space that they found, and it's really reinvigorated certainly my wife's artistic interests, and they do inspire each other, even though they don't work together, and it's a lot of fun. And my granddaughter was in there as the third generation at her own easel, so that. It the beat goes on. So I'm proud of both of them, and I think they're all talented.
Yeah, no, they're very talented and very different. I always wonder, like, do they walk in like and look at each other's work from the day before? Like, I might do it differently. I'm sure they keep it to themselves. But
well, they really are each other's cheerleaders, and they do look at each other's work. So I think if any criticism would be constructive between them, or there would be a world war. The only thing they could agree on is if I got in the middle of it and said anything.
That's funny. So, and Jeff's wife is named Jenny Franks, and she's a playwright and a filmmaker. But I got to say it, Jeff, because every time anybody hears this, at least of our generation, they kind of go like, are you in, really? Like, that's crazy. So Jeff's wife, Jenny, was at one time married to Ian Anderson from Jethro Tull. And Jenny co-wrote Aqualung, which is such an iconic song. And I just, when I first heard that, I went crazy. The lyric goes, snot's running, which he gives her credit for. Snot's running down her nose, greasy fingers, smearing shabby clothes. For a kid from Philly who loves booger jokes, like when I heard that, I just went crazy. Anyway, if you could speak to that a little bit.
Well, yeah, she wrote the lyrics to Aqualung. And I think she may have worked on some other songs also writing the lyrics. And it's also Jenny's birthday today. Happy birthday to Jenny. Jenny's she's done some one woman shows. She's been she had a playwrights festival that morphed into an organization that puts Latina girls through college. That's a pretty great thing that she does with that. And she's a very creative person. She just finished writing a book for herself. And, we have kind of a artistic life here in Mons.
That's great. And how did you meet her?
We met through a mutual friend who was from England. My wife's English. And he was a friend of hers in England, and the late Robert Mundy. And we went to the Mandarette Cafe one night, and the rest is history. We, married very soon after that.
Because you had dated a bunch, and you had mentioned Margot Kidder earlier. You had dated.
Everybody's dated a bunch, Tim.
No,
I've been married for 37 years.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. Good for
there's
you.
There's no room in my folder for dated a bunch.
That's really funny. Well put. So guys, do you, I mean, you're both retired now to an extent. Do you guys miss Hollywood?
I don't miss Hollywood, but I miss hanging out with Jeff.
You know, that is the truth. I mean, Peter and I, we had so many many laughs. We would just laugh ourselves sick. As a matter of fact, one time Peter had broken his ribs. It was in the office, and we were just, he was laying down on a couch, and we started telling something, and he started laughing. He fell off the couch, and he cracked his ribs again, and we had to take him to the hospital. And there were a bunch of Chinese people in the waiting room who had, you know, brand new clothes on. And they
had jumpsuits on.
How did you?
They had jumpsuits on. And then when he, what?
How did you know they were brand new? Were they labeled?
Because you could, I mean, the soles of their shoes did not have a dark mark on them.
It's funny you'd notice.
So we're looking at them and we're thinking, you know, like, what just happened here? And I don't know why I'm telling this, but anyway, after Peter went in to see the doctor and have himself taped up, I said, what's the deal with these people? And they said, well, they're from China, and we were showing the sanitation department, and they were standing on a ramp over one of the sanitation pools, and the ramp collapsed and they all fell in over their heads. Oh, over their heads in raw sewage.
Wow.
So they were coming in to get their shots. That's the kind of day that Peter and I would have almost every day.
Back to the new clothing. So they obviously changed into new clothing because
right.
It was covered. Yeah,
because the old clothing had to be incinerated. I said to their guide, hey, next time take him to Disneyland.
I do have to say, guys, going back and looking at Tales from the Crypt, where we first met, and Johnny Bago, it was so fun. I mean, your attitudes towards the work was always sort of like, have fun first. We'll get it shot. Don't worry. But we're not going to freak out about this stuff. That really came through to me, at least watching you guys.
That's true. And I'll say that we had a limited amount of success with that theory. I mean, we had people were always trying to figure out how are we doing this? Why didn't we care? Why didn't we care? So I used to say, you know, Peter and I knew this wasn't going to last forever. So I said, why don't we buy nail parlors? And we owned at one time 75% of the nail parlors in Los Angeles, and had to like fight it out with these Korean guys after having a meeting at Paramount. You know, it was a lot of responsibility, but we didn't need show business because we had this other thing.
You got your next movie. Okay, we're going to wrap it up here. Thank you guys so much. Peter Seaman and Jeff Price, great screenwriters, great friends. Really fun having you here. I knew it would be fun. Do a couple of plugs before we go for those guys. Jeff's book, Improbable Fortunes, you can buy on Amazon. Peter's documentary, West of the West, about the Channel Islands, you can see on Amazon. Me, Sprung, and Twitter, at TV's Tim Stack. Special thanks to Dr. D, the engineer, Richard Dugan, and Jeremiah Higgins, who does all of this for all of you, because this is all part of the Jeremiah Show. Really a great thank you to him. I'll see you next time on It's Radio with TV's Tim Stack.
Gentlemen, you're clear. Great program.
That was great, guys. Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Tim.
Hey, thanks a lot, Tim. That was really great.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
It's fun. It's fun for me. It's like, literally, like, you know, I look at the internet, I look at credits, I think of stuff, it's fun. And then I come in here and it's super easy.
Go.
So
there you go.
Anyway, guys, thank you. Jeff, say happy birthday to Jenny. That's great.
I will. You know, I hope to see you guys someday.
Come out and play golf with us, Jeff.
Come out. Play golf.
I should probably do that. Okay. You guys are okay with everything there? Everything's not sliding away or anything?
Not this week.
Oh, no, no.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, I know. It's not exactly the dreamland that, you know, that it was like in the 1950s.
No.
But no place is.
Yeah, I was going to say, no place is.
I don't have a hometown anymore.
Yeah.
I was born and raised in Phoenix. I go back there. Where the hell am I?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, Peter and I, we played golf down there, and I just couldn't believe it. It's like a mini Los Angeles.
Yeah, it is. By the way, I was in one of the major intersections. I was back there a year or so ago, and I was going through with a buddy of mine. I swear to God, they could put a baseball diamond in the middle of one of these intersections. It's enormous.
Right.
Unreal. Anyway.
Guys, thank you again.
Great.
I'll let you know when this is up and running. It'll go to the podcast first, and then they'll put it on YouTube. So I'll let you know.
And I'll take out your profanity, too. I'll bleep it.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Oh, no. That's okay. Another way I love to do it, though, Tim, take the word and play it backwards.
Oh, that's funny.
Okay.
Well, then, Jeff, you could have said dick.
I could have said dick then. Put that dick joke back in, will you?
Okay.
I mean, it's sad when your whole career comes down to that, doesn't it?
Yeah, well.
The dick joke.
All right, guys.
See you guys.